I've been over in Australia for almost 10 years, and this is my 20th trip to Wellington now. And I'm pleased to say, I was just telling some people in the audience earlier on, it's the second trip when it's not been raining, which makes me a little bit sad, because it reminds me of home, where there's the sort of rain that you have to walk into to get wet, which I'm quite fond of, so my British roots yearn for it. Anyway, thank you for having me here. I do appreciate it. I think I've got 40 minutes or so to run through a presentation. Tracy alluded to the fact that I love talking, so I will probably go long. So somebody at the back of the room, just do this and I'll hurry it along. I get the great opportunity in my role, apart from the fact we work with a fantastic team of now over 100 sustainability professionals, both here and in Australia. I get the great opportunity to work with our international teams on considering the significant trends that are reshaping the world that we work in. I always start most of these talks with a couple of quotes, and I've chosen these two today. The first is the social commentator Eric Qualman, who states that within the next 10 years, 40% of the Fortune 500 won't exist. Now, that's a little bit of a scare tactic in the sense that it's not going to be the case that all small disruptive tech companies are going to replace the companies of today, although they will have a significant impact. This is the fact we're also seeing globalization leading to consolidation of organizations. So we're seeing much more of a consolidated approach to organizations being brought together. The second quote comes from our own research, and it's the quote I give to the partnership in this region, which is, by 2020, half of the workforce are going to be Gen Y and Gen Z, sometimes referred to as the millennials, and they don't think like you do. Now, that's an interesting comment because it's based on some research out of the United States, which shows that the I generation, my children's age, I've got three kids, 7-year-old and 5-year-old twins, which I'm away for the whole week, by the way, so I get a respite. The way that they interact with technology means that their brains are actually developing in a new way. So there is now medical research to suggest that the mapping of children's brains is different today than it was when we grew up. And that means that we'll never learn to be able to interact with technology in the way that they do. They're changing, they don't think like us. I also wanted to put up this quote. This is a particularly impressive chap called Professor Mervyn King from South Africa. He was the guy that put the King 3 Code of Conduct, now the King 4 Code of Conduct in place, which requires organizations there to disclose their ESG performance. And he pushed against the Milton Friedman concept of requiring organizations to be separate from society. It's actually a misquote of Milton Friedman. I'll bore you with that another time. But he says that companies are a part of society and not apart from it. And we couldn't agree more. The picture in the background is the Samarco Chilean disaster that we saw last year, where alongside a number of deaths and significant damage, as you can clearly see, to people's homes, we've also seen a significant impact in relation to the organizations associated with that and their bottom line. Just over a year ago, we had the VW emissions scandal. And whilst you might imagine that, you know, being part of the practice that deals with the environmental aspects of what we do at EY, I would start to focus on the fact that they cheated around emissions necessarily, and it's a really core part. That was less of an issue for us in the context of what it means to those businesses. It was really a delineation between businesses you can trust and businesses that you can't. You know, these were cars that people bought on the basis of the noise that the door makes when you close them, the safety factor. And if you can't trust what they're doing with emissions, how can you trust them in other ways? What's interesting, though, is that it's had a profound impact to them financially as well. And I'd like to come back to this because I constantly get this question, which is, oh, sure, so we've had the Deepwater Horizon issue, we've had other environmental disasters, but what we've seen in the share market is a dip and a rally over time, so it doesn't really have a material impact to that business. Well, so far it's cost them $14.7 billion in direct fines and recall costs. Not a single civil suit has settled yet. And commentators in the markets are indicating that it's going to be somewhere between $40 and $120 billion, depending on who you believe and how hard they'll be impacted. And at the upper range, obviously, Volkswagen goes out of business. Now, again, commentators in the economic field are saying that they are unlikely to go out of business, but it was definitely not the case at the time when they were discussing it initially. So significant impacts from arguably environmental aspects. This young lady is Ms. Theresa May. For those of you that don't know, she took over from David Cameron in the UK after we had a somewhat surprising small majority that led to an election upset or a leadership upset anyway, pre-election. And that was the move to move the United Kingdom out of Europe. Now, hilariously, because I've said we spend our time thinking about trends, about 18 months ago, I stood up on a platform in a conference just like this one, and we predicted this was going to happen, if not from the UK, then from one other major state within the European Union. And I was laughed off stage. And yet here we are today, and since Ms. May, we've had the man in orange appear, who's also driven in the same direction, that same social tapping, he's tapped into that social discontent that we've started to see within society, and played to the polemics of politics in a way that we haven't seen for a long while. And what we are saying, certainly in our space, is that this is a move away from a post-war era of reasonably benign regulation. Many of you might argue with me in the audience, and I've had a couple of rather frazzled looking executives say to me afterwards, you don't know what you're talking about. But we have had 3 decades of reasonably benign politics and reasonably benign regulation. I know you don't feel like that in your businesses when you're doing your corporate reporting and the requirements are hitting you for a 30th of June deadline. However, reasonably benign as to what we're likely to see going forward. And the reason for that is that politicians have always rallied behind business because they have been the major contributor of economic growth. So it's really been, how do you support those significant businesses with their growth agenda, because it aligns to the GDP story that we've seen politics and governments try to lead with. That's gone. We're in the end of that era. And we're now at the position where nationalism from governments is actually going to drive loggerheads with business. And we're already starting to see it, where politicians are pointing fingers at businesses and telling them what they should be doing, whether it's within their right or not to do so. We've seen that in Australian politics, where the government there have told the banks that they should be passing on rate decreases from the Reserve Bank of Australia, even though that isn't a mandatory legal requirement of them to do that, and they're indexed not entirely against the RBA. We've clearly seen that in the United States with Mr. Trump, President Trump, driving Apple to say that they need to be manufacturing their iPhones and other products within the United States. And we're going to increasingly start to see that as we get to this position of border protectionism. And what we do start to see when it's coming out in terms of regulation is those governments are driving it through tax efficiencies and current regulatory markets. So we're seeing border tax adjustments being discussed once more, which is kind of the opposite of what we started to see with the increase of globalization and the move towards a free trade. So corporate diplomacy is increasingly as important as sovereign diplomacy, and I genuinely mean that. I'll push that point a little bit more later on. But really what we like to talk about in the megatrend space is not just the changes coming, and it can be profound, but the speed of that change. So we have to look back to try and give you an example of that speed of that change. And I always like to talk about Uber because everyone knows who they are, because they're in almost every developed nation in the world now. But I want to give you an example of the speed at which they took over an incumbent marketplace. The graph on the left-hand side shows you between March 2014 and March 2015 the share of rides that Uber had in the private car market. So that's taxis and private services and limousines. That's basically any car that you might rent which isn't yours. They had 12% of that national market in 2014, which is pretty impressive. They hadn't been around for very long. Within 1 year, they were half of the marketplace. That's a phenomenal intervention into a classic market. However, you'll notice I haven't used the word disruption, which you'll be hearing all the time at the moment, because it's actually not a disruptive business model. Their business model was clearly one of a new technology that can intervene in a current marketplace which was stayed. On the right-hand side, this is a disruptive business model. Netflix, and not the Netflix that you guys know that stream movies, but the Netflix where you used to be able to go online and order your DVD, they would send it to you in the post, you'd be able to watch your DVD in your own time, and for one price, you could send it back the next day or the next week or if you wanted to the next month. they tapped into a sleeping marketplace that the Blockbuster video stores weren't addressing. Blockbuster had a very fixed model. You went in on the day, if they had it, you could have it. You had to get it back by the next day, or you had these sort of daily fines. And in fact, a lot of their revenue model was built on people not bringing back DVDs. They tapped into that marketplace and they built up a base that allowed them, over the period of 6 years, to significantly intervene in Blockbuster's market. And they built up a capital pool that they then reinvested, because they'd invested in the IT technology for you to interact with them, and they had a rich social database on you. They knew what their customers liked, they knew their habits and their preferences. And by 2010, before they launched streaming services, Blockbuster had died. So why do we care and what do we do? Well, we're a professional services organization that doesn't make anything, so we're the product of a whole bunch of people around the world, 250,000 people now, which is crazy when I think about it. But all we do is really think about the future, because we like to try and be one step ahead of the companies that we service, so that we can give them some sound advice, or at least lead them in the right direction. And so we carry out analysis, which has ended up this year in these 8 megatrends. There were 6 last year, there's 8 this year. I don't know if the trend is that we'll be just going out in perpetuity. Come back in 5 years and I'll have 20 for you. But basically they're broken up on the basis of political, environmental, technological, social, economic, and cultural changes and analysis that we see out over time. And they fall into these 8 categories. I'm not going to run through them all. We don't have time. We do have some thought leadership that you guys can read in these topics and these areas if you wish. The one area that we focus on, probably unsurprisingly in our practice, is resourceful planet, the use of resources and their finite nature. And we will touch on some of those, but I'll touch on some of the others too, because they're important. The majority of what we talk about in this megatrend space, though, is hinged on the fact that we have a significant shift in demographics. We know that by 2025, 20 of the world's richest cities in the top 50 will be in Asia. And at the same time, half of Europeans' top 50 cities are going to fall off that list. There's a significant move in terms of wealth from west to east, which again is that polemic from the post-war era. Worth mentioning if you didn't know, but within this circle here, that's half the world's population in 2030. And between 2011 and 2030, we're seeing an increase in the middle class wealth from just India and China from 6% to 35%. So a third of all of the middle class will be sitting in either India or China in as little as 2030. That's also playing out in terms of megacities. So those cities which have more than 10 million people in them, the megatropolises as we used to call them when there was just Tokyo and New York. But in 1970, we just had Tokyo and New York as those megacities, and that seemed almost an impossible dream that you'd be able to get so many people into a small space. Today, we've got 23, and by 2030, there are going to be 41 megacities. And a number of those I can barely pronounce. And that's because the growth in those cities that we're starting to see across Asia is not coming from our staid capitals. So the growth in Beijing is sub 4%, but the growth in the Surat is beyond 15%, year-on-year growth. Phenomenal growth of these megacities. And as a trend, we're also starting to see sustainability in smart cities creep into this space, because they recognize that consumers and employees value the sustainability concepts and the community concepts of cities now. They want the best of both worlds. And so those clever planners are thinking through, how do they make sustainable cities an attractive point of difference so that you go to Surat and not New York? Data. Data's the new oil, right? It's the new stream of revenue. And we can see that in the empirical evidence. It's withstood the test of the global financial crisis. The numbers over on the left-hand side show data from the UK that through the global financial crisis, businesses who primarily said that their model was based on the use of data and customer data grew between 15 and 100%. They really outstripped the market expectation of decline. We do know in this region, though, that 80% of all customer data is not being used by the organisations that manage it. So we know that an awful lot of your businesses are currently taking in a great deal of data, but they're failing to use a lot of that information. Below my little security camera and the spy, this is where our classic scepticism of professional services comes in, and particularly us on the ethical side, we're slightly concerned that the ethical frameworks around data aren't in place yet. So the one thing we do know about the use of data, analytical tools, and big data, and big data for a long time I called teenage sex because everyone talks about it, no one's doing it, no one knew what it was. But we do now have a number of organizations that are fundamentally using big data in very new and very scary ways. I tell this tale that I got rid of my mobile phone because it was listening to my wife and I chatting in bed. So I don't know if you know, but some of the apps that you have on your mobile phone, before you accept them, require you to either access your photos or your video library or whatever it may be. Many of them require an access to your microphone. And some of those have passive listening. So when they're on standby, they listen for keywords. They use those keywords to sell through social media networks. So my wife and I were chatting about my son getting a bit unruly and wanting to put him in a judo school. The next day, judo in the local region. The very next night, we were chatting about the fact that I've spent far too much money on a mattress that I think is uncomfortable. Mattress stores in the local region. Now the really interesting thing for me, and this plays to this concept of the millennials and their purchase decisions, is I went back to the Sydney office that I was in at the time, and I sat down with my team. We've got a team of 40 people in Sydney. And I said to them, can you believe, you know, the IT advisory guys have just told me my phone is actually listening to me. I'm going out, and I went and bought an Apple phone. And the room split into two people, two sides. One side said, that's hideous. I can't believe that they're breaching your privacy in that way. The other side said, but they kind of answered your question. So you had an issue, and they gave you a solution to that issue. And really, what have you given up in terms of your privacy? They thought that it was fine for you to be able to give that level of privacy and information because the reward that they received was greater than what they believed they'd given up. And that divide was people over the age of 30 and people under the age of 30. And that's a true story. Now, what's interesting is that we've started to see evidence coming through. Time magazine wrote an article on some research that's been done in the US that demonstrates that 3/4 of all millennials will now be checking the sustainability credentials of the businesses that they interact with and the consumer products that they buy. And what's fascinating about this research, Star Labs in the Boston universities have started to look at that dynamic very specifically because, and I know this personally, I used to work in farming regulation in the UK in government, and we did all this research on organic farming. And you go and ask everybody, and everybody goes, yes, we want to buy organic. They go to the shops and they don't, because it's more expensive. That's not true for millennials when it relates to sustainable products. They are willing to pay a premium in a way that many of us in this room, not trying to be rude, won't. So maybe the people in this room probably will. You're a skewed audience. You're a biased pool. We're also seeing a change in loyalty from customers as well. And this is kind of fascinating in the context of this polemic between the above 30s and the below 30s. And that's really that we have had for a number of years, particularly the baby boomers and the Gen Xs, affinity for certain brands that we have grown up with. I mean, I don't know if you guys remembered, but about 15 years ago, Coca-Cola were going to rebrand in the US, and there was a public outcry and campaign that you can't lose Coke, it's an American brand. Well, now today we're not seeing that. We're actually seeing loyalty lying with aggregators. So not the underlying businesses that actually provide you with the products or services that you're using, but the aggregators of those information, the Airtaskers, the Airbnbs, the Spotifys, or the Ubers. And that's interesting, of course, because that loyalty comes from the direct connectivity that people have with them on a day-to-day basis through their technology and not the services that they're delivering. And in fact, they can distance themselves from poor service because they aren't seen as the person delivering that. They're seen as the person helping to put you in touch. Fascinating. Don't ask me what that means, by the way. But I'll tell you what it does mean in the context of organizations out of the US is that we're starting to see smart companies who recognize that their products might not be the products of the future intervening in social marketplaces. Levi's, for example, use social commentators to work through God, now I'm going to show my age, Snapchat and Instagram and other video messaging services to be able to start to say, Levi's products are great because of these reasons. And they're seeing a real uptick in sales because of it. And denim products, for example, which were predicted to go massively out of fashion, remain in fashion. Anyway, let's talk employees. I've talked about the Gen Yers. There's a great paper, I believe it's Harvard Business Review that wrote it, that says, watch out, Gen Y, Gen X is coming. And what it means is that at the moment, the leaders globally, whether that's the heads of state or the heads of corporations, tend to be baby boomers. And baby boomers get on pretty well with Gen Y because they're often their kids or their grandchildren. And they're the ones that have told them they should be everything, can be anything, and in fact, why don't you be president or go to the moon? Now, Gen Xers, however, we've been bred on harder stuff. We've been bred on grit and dirt and work hard and you'll achieve. And it turns out that Gen X and Gen Y are likely to get on far less well than the baby boomers and the Gen Yers themselves. So a number of social commentators are saying, watch out, we've got some tricky situations coming up. But what we do know is that the expectations of this millennial group are very different. And if we don't tap into those expectations and use them appropriately, we're really not going to be able to generate the best value that we can from our workforce. You know, a true story again, 2 weeks ago, one of my team members came up to me and said, they're slightly concerned and they wanted my advice. We sat down. They said, I've been in the business for 2 and a little bit years. I'm slightly worried that I'm going to be here for 3 and my CV is going to look stale. That could not be more different from the career that I had, where I was worried if I was in a business for 2 years and moving on that my CV would look peppered. So we're in a really strange and very different universe. And as I say, the difference between, and this makes me feel slightly heartened by the way, the difference between the Y generation and the I generation, my children, is also going to be just as profound a difference, so they're going to cause them just as much trouble. Great. Okay. But in some ways, do we have to worry about it? If we go to the Pew Research Institute, they tell us that 47% of current jobs today are going to be automated, or at least at high risk of being automated in the next 20 years. And we believe them. Not least of which, because their research is actually quite incredibly powerful. But we know that the current jobs today that we have are very highly likely to be automated. And many of us feel quite safe because we go, well, that's okay, because that'll be cars. We know that automated, car drivers are going to be automated. That makes sense. Factories. We know that factory lines are going to be automated. That makes sense. Actually, any role where a binary decision needs to be made can be automated. So that is, for example, defects on a factory line, where you have to make a decision as to if there is a defect or not a defect. It's also cardiothoracic surgery. And there is, in fact, a robot around today that is watching cardiothoracic surgeons around the world to try and understand how they carry out those tasks so that they can improve them. And I use the word improve appropriately. Alison, good question.
I'm sorry to interrupt your flow. I've just got a question from Liz Reed at Reputation Matters in Napier. She just wants a little bit more clarity about, you described Uber as an intervener and Netflix as a disruptor. Just wants a little bit more clarity about what the difference is.
Oh man, that's really nerdy. It actually comes down to the US university approach to how they classify disruptions. So disruption should be something that addresses a sleeping marketplace and changes a mode or model, whereas technically Uber is an improvement or an efficiency. If for example, the taxi industry came up with an app so that you could use them more appropriately, we wouldn't say they've disrupted their own business, we'd say they've created an efficiency. Netflix approached, so the model for Blockbuster was that it was a store model where you had to be near a store, you went into one. Netflix didn't care if you lived in the highest part of Hawaii or in the plains of Arizona. They just addressed a sleeping marketplace. So that's I can send out if you want the classic definition, but I'm getting quite nerdy about it. So the concept of automation are pretty interesting, right? So if we take that through to STAR, which is a cute name for the soft tissue autonomous robot, 4 months ago, STAR actually carried out its first surgeries. Don't worry, they were on pigs. And I say don't worry because I assume that you might be concerned that there's a robot working on people, but they carried out surgeries, soft tissue surgeries, and they did that against a number of surgeons who were doing it at the same time to track performance of the robot against those surgeons. Shock horror, the robot was better than every surgeon. in every case, and it does so with a very close to zero chance of post-infection, because it can do it in a completely sterile environment, whereas we're starting to see infection rates from soft tissue go up, actually. So this is kind of interesting again, because I come back to the conversation I was having with you guys earlier about this polemic in terms of acceptability. Because I had this conversation around cardiothoracic surgery when I was giving a talk in Sydney a little while ago, and a couple of people came up to me afterwards and said, it's all very well, but I wouldn't let a robot work on me. But the truth is, those robots will never be drunk, they will never be late, ever. So you will have a scheduled surgery and you will be on time and you will have that surgery. But they'll also never be worrying about whether they need to pick the kids up from cricket. They aren't limited by the human factor. And in fact, they also have access to research in real time that can be applied in real time. So the Lancet produces something in a medical journal somewhere at 4 a.m. and you've got a surgery at 5 past 4, they intervene. Were we scared yet?
No.
Well, let's make it scarier. Of the 100 largest economies, 40 are now companies, not countries. The annual turnover of Walmart is just close to half a trillion dollars. And the GDP of Pakistan is about $250 billion. Pretty incredible stuff. We know that social media platforms now outrank countries in terms of the number of constituents. So there are more people on Facebook than there are people in China. What I've got here, increasing power, wealth, and political autonomy, cities will increase their relative importance. And this is actually what we're starting to see. We're starting to see in our predictions a removal from interactions from companies with country-level governments, moving down to the state or even the city level, because they're having a much larger impact and influence. We're seeing that in the US right now, where states are pushing their own agenda. We're seeing that in Australia right now, particularly as it relates to climate change, as we have a vast majority of states and territories of Australia who have set out targets around the 2050 zero carbon agenda, when there isn't quite the same agenda at the federal level. And whilst we touch on climate change, how am I going for time, Tracy? Are we okay? Great. Whilst we touch on climate change, we can't really talk about it without going back to Paris. So December 2015, possibly, at least for me, one of the most historic dates that we are likely to see in our generation. The Paris Agreement was signed and then ratified by over 195 countries. I think 197 countries now have ratified Paris. And what that means is that we are, at least in terms of the agreement, we are aligned to keeping global temperatures to within 2 degrees from the pre-industrial era, and aspirations of keeping them within 1.5 degrees of that same period. That is to say, that's pre the 1900s. So we're actually already half the way towards that 1 degree, arguably 1.2 degrees, depending on who you believe. And I really like showing this graph because it's so simple and it's the one that everyone ignores. So this graph here is our growth in emissions trajectory over a period of time up until roughly today. And then the three lines are the major three trend lines of the thousands of climate predictions that have been put in place, the majority of which come now through from the Goddard Institute, the NASA Goddard Institute in New York City. This is what happens if we don't do anything, our current policy scenario. Actually, I shouldn't say if we don't do anything. This is what happens with all of the current climate legislation that we have in place or penned to have in place. This blue line is our new policy scenario. That's if everybody puts into place everything that they promised that they would in Paris. And the green line is what we signed up for. And this green line shows, and I haven't taken it off from 2040, but it shows that we have to be net zero carbon in the second half of the century. Now, I don't know if that's as profound to you as it is to me, but we have to be a zero carbon economy. Now, we talk about businesses facing a low carbon future. There is no low carbon future, there is a zero carbon future. We have to be net zero in order to avoid the most catastrophic impacts of a changing climate. What's interesting though, from a corporate perspective, at least until very recently, is most companies talk about this. They talk about the blue scenario. How do we fare in a blue scenario? And for the first time, we've started to see international standard setters and regulators voice their concern about organisations not addressing this 2-degree scenario future. So we had Mark Carney from the Bank of England stand up and say that it's the greatest economic change that we're likely to face, and it shouldn't be on the horizon. It's something we should be facing today. I agree with him, by the way. I think it's the largest economic disruption we're going to see globally in our generation and possibly the next. I say that twice because I think it's really important. The largest economic disruption we'll likely see in the next 2 decades. But we've also seen the Australian Prudential Regulatory Authority stand up a little over a week and a half ago, and for the first time say, for the banking, financial services and insurance sector, this is a fundamental disruption that needs to be taken into consideration, and they expect to see in their disclosures considerations on a 2-degree scenario, so how they avoid being part of the, you know, the lost corporates, part of Eric Qualman's 40%. We've also got the Financial Stability Board's task force on climate-related financial disclosures, a mouthful, led by Michael Bloomberg, which again is coming out globally and saying we need to have consistent reporting as it relates to climate disclosures. And I say economic because it's a big number. This is Citi's research, which by some estimations it remains conservative, but $44 trillion by 2060 being the cumulative cost of climate change. Okay. Hopefully you're not falling into a deep depression in the back. And it's pretty important because, don't forget, we're still working within a 2-degree change. And a 2-degree change in and of itself, even if we meet that green line, which I really hope we do, even within that line, we've got some significant changes we have to deal with. We know that 21 of the world's 37 largest aquifers are already reaching their sustainability tipping point. And we know that if we're going to meet that 2-degree scenario, or the 450 parts per million, as it's called in the climate conferences, we need to have 18% of all of our liquid fuels being biofuels. We're in the low single digits right now. This is a significant change. And interestingly, one that New Zealand's had a powerful part in playing on. So Z Energy, who have established their biofuels refinery up in Auckland, and Air New Zealand with Virgin, who have come out with a tender for 5% of all of their fuels to come from biofuels. Those sort of market signals are leading in the right direction as it relates to biofuels. But also we know that the electrification, both of our electricity network from renewable sources, but also of vehicles that are currently used by fossil fuels, is going to take effect. Bloomberg New Energy Finance research shows that within 10 years, 35% of total global car sales are going to be electric cars, by 2040. And we know that they're going to be cheaper within the next decade than their competitors. We actually think this is massively conservative, and it was done before regulators in Europe started to put in place requirements that there would be no fossil fuel-based vehicles coming into the country. So the Netherlands, Norway, and it very much looks like France and Germany as well, which is an incredible change. You know, the powerful, expensive car manufacturers in France and Germany suddenly deciding that in as little as 8 years' time, none of their cars can be fossil fuel derived. That's pretty powerful stuff. But it has some great impacts too, right? So 13 million barrels per day change in terms of a consumption pattern just from the new energy finance data alone. Okay, anybody know this guy? I've yet to have an audience that does know him, by the way. He's the CEO and chairman of BlackRock, the world's largest investor. So he's worth tapping in for a loan if you really fancy one. So maybe remember that face. Every year he writes out to the top 500 organizations and he sets out for them his expectations of the marketplace for the year. There's one due soon, but last year, his entire 16-page dossier faced sustainability issues and risks. It was like manna from heaven from us in our space. And one of the things that he really set out that we could not agree more with is that he's asking CEOs to lay out a strategic framework for long-term value creation. And on top of that it needs to be signed off by the board. So it can't just be something which is a castaway from the organizations without the board themselves being across it. These slides are actually embargoed because the research isn't out for another few weeks, but I wanted to share them with you here today because it's so powerful. We asked over 300 institutional investors globally around a number of the factors that Larry Fink set out in his letter to see what their response was. We do this survey, it's the third survey, it's due in a few weeks' time. If you aren't already on our mailing lists, do get on them because this is great research, and I'm not biased because I helped write it. I'm partially biased because I helped write it. But we asked them a number of things. So the top question, which was the quote that I've just given you, 92% of global investors either agree or strongly agree with that sentiment. He said, environmental and social issues offer both risk and opportunities, but for too long, companies have not considered them core to their businesses. 82% of global investors, these are the largest investment firms in the world, over 300 responses that we had this year, said that they agree or strongly agree. Generating sustainable returns over time requires a sharper focus not only on governance, but also environmental and social factors. Again, near to 90% agree or strongly agree. And it's important that we ask these questions because often when we talk about ESG or environmental and social governance, it's pushed away by a number of executives in the concept of yes, but that's really around good governance. It's not around the social or environmental aspects. Well, this information is showing that investors disagree. Over the long term, environmental, social, and governance issues, ranging from climate change to diversity of board effectiveness, have real and quantifiable impacts. Again, 91% agree or strongly agree. This data really threw us for six. It's really quite powerful. And it didn't stop there. 81 said they're now paying much closer attention following recent environmental social non-compliances. So some of those non-compliances we touched on in the opening slides. 76% said boards should have mandatory oversight on sustainability disclosures. And 62%, nearly two-thirds of all investors, said they are either watching or already changed investments due to stranded asset risk. That is to say that they believe some organizations are overvalued because the assets which they hold in the ground will never be extracted due to economic reasons. We never thought we'd hear investors talk like this. But in truth, they should be the canaries in the mine, and arguably they now are. The last questions that we asked them in terms of new questions for this year, we try to keep them reasonably consistent for trend data, was around this 2-degree concept. So we said, okay, if we've got Paris and when there's therefore a requirement for organizations to work in this brave new world, shouldn't they be reporting on it? And one in four investors agreed with us very strongly. They said there should be dramatic increases in climate disclosures around and their risk management strategies. And another 60% almost said there should be at least moderate improvements in that space. I really would love to know who the 14% are that don't believe we should have greater disclosures, because I hope my superannuation and pensions aren't with them. So what does this all mean for businesses? Because in truth, that was my 5-minute call from the back of the room, by the way. They know me way too well. What does that mean for businesses? Because in reality, of course, I've been talking as though it's doom and gloom, but in truth, it's not. What I've really mentioned here is that businesses are now in the driving seat to make systemic change. And they can do that by tapping into the social conscience of the consumers that they interact with. And so last year, 1st of January 2016, we saw the Equator Principles roll into the Sustainable Development Goals. 17 goals set out to try and reach global aims of equality and basically working within planetary limits. It's actually 16 goals, with the 17th being participation and drawing together and partnering on those goals. Now, what's interesting is, and I wouldn't mind a show of hands from the audience, how many of you guys have already considered SDGs in your own businesses? Okay, a good number of you. How many of you have done anything other than take the 17 goals and map them against what you're already doing? That's very impressive. We had some hands in the audience, and that's actually very impressive. You are in a vast, vast minority of companies who have done anything other than mapping currently what those goals mean to what you're currently doing. Now, that doesn't mean that what you're doing is wrong, but I think we're going to start to see a greater alignment here. And this goal here, the partnering, we're going to have to see a closer partnership between governments and companies in order to effect appropriate change. EY is working with a number of companies on that out of New York right now. This image is a demonstration of spending that EY tracks. We haven't put the numbers on there because we're not allowed to. But spending that we track in relation to business spend on sustainable initiatives, so sustainability initiatives, or initiatives aligned to the purpose of the company. And what we saw through the global financial crisis was sustainability spending got cut, as many nodding heads in the room probably acknowledge. But where it was aligned to the purpose of the enterprise, that spending went up, which makes sense, right? I mean, if there's an initiative which is aligned to the purpose, if there is a shared value created from what you're doing for the business and your consumers and your employees, then why would you stop spending during hard times? That's where you want to spend that money. And many of us in the sustainability space kind of felt heartbroken when sustainability programs were cut, because that's the time to spend, you would imagine. So why is it that purpose is becoming more of a powerful message for executive leadership? Well, there's a good number of reasons why when you look at the research. From an employee perspective, we know that purpose-led organizations, those companies that don't just have a mission, they actually have a purpose. I work with one company whose mission is to maximize returns to shareholders. Nothing like getting behind that as an employee, I'm sure. But if you have a purpose-led enterprise, we know that you're 1.4 times more engaged and 1.7 times more satisfied in your role, and that leads to a 3 times greater likelihood of you staying. Now, for companies like EY, that's fundamentally important. All we are is people. We're the product of the people that we have, and we spend a lot of money on training people. We spend an awful lot of money on training people. And if somebody doesn't stay with us for, you know, the 2-year scenario that I was giving you, we actually don't get the return from the investment that we've put into those people. So this is really important to us. And a couple of years ago, we changed from our mission, which was quality in everything we do, which is quite yawn, to building a better working world, which is a purpose under which all of our team keep me honest on. The work that we're doing, how is that helping us build a better working world? That's a powerful message. Attracting, retaining, and engaging customers. We went out to our clients, and we went to our clients who have purpose-driven sentiment in their businesses. So we work closely with a number of organizations, but you know, the Paul Polmans, the Virgin Atlantics, all of these guys who have set a really clear purpose on what they're doing and how they do it. And we asked them around their customer retention, and they said 89% of clients believe purpose-driven companies will deliver the highest quality products and services. 72% of global consumers would recommend a company with a purpose, which is a 40% increase on our previous study. And 84% of emerging market consumers make cause-related purchases at least annually. So we know that purpose-led organizations have a significant return in relation to their customer base. But now we know, and I was just sharing this with somebody in the audience before, we now have a period of time of sustainability. We have beyond a decade now, so we have empirical evidence that we can demonstrate in now thousands of academic papers. Oxford University did a review last year, which is incredibly good, and I'd encourage you to read. We know that sustainable enterprises outperform on every metric that you might wish to look at. Employee retention, shareholder price, almost everything, shareholder value. Purpose-led organizations outperformed the Standard & Poor's 500 10 times between 1996 and 2011. And meaningful brands connected to human well-being outperformed the stock market 120% in 2013. I could literally go on for the next 2 hours giving you papers, because I felt the need to do that research myself, because I felt the need to engage with executives to tell them why they should be doing something from an economic perspective. And a lot of it for a long time had been gut. It's what we saw in the marketplace. Well, we don't have to do that anymore. There's empirical evidence. So the engine force of all companies then surely should be the sustainability professional. Hurrah from the audience, I'm sure. But for too long, we've been sitting with corporate communications and corporate affairs. And my view personally is that sustainability has to be called a strategy. And I say that because most companies' strategic outlook is 3 years, and at best, 5. And 5 years is a pretty weak outlook, in my view, when a number of the megatrends that we've touched on, we've glanced on in the last 40 minutes, go long beyond 5 years. Some of them go out a number of decades. But if you aren't making those adjustments in your business today, or those investments to either you know, mitigate those risks or address those opportunities, how are you truly going to be able to have a strategic enterprise which is creating value over the long term? So I very much think that we need to understand those global forces. We need to do appropriate scenario planning. An awful lot of what we do is scenario plans. You know, the future is unknown and therefore imperfect. But you should be then feeding those. They should be the filter through which strategy is seen. Every single, you know, below 5-year strategy should pass through a sustainability filter. And if it gets caught in that filter, then it shouldn't go ahead. And we've started to see companies take that on board. So Qantas, for example, in its latest announcements and annual reporting, started to talk about the global forces that underpin the way that it sets its strategy. So it thinks about these significant global forces, including climate change, as to how it sets its short-term strategies. Thank you very much.
Hi, Matt. Great presentation. That was really interesting. I was particularly interested in the slide on purpose-led companies and, you know, some very compelling statistics there. But I was just wondering whether you could offer any insight around, you know, what defines an effective purpose versus, you know, I mean, surely there's a huge spectrum there between an effective purpose and an ineffective purpose.
Yeah. So in short, Grant, I can. EY has actually established something called a purpose-led transformation approach, which is to look at it very scientifically and again, a little bit geeky, but actually to set up a framework that you need to pass through. And again, it's a kind of a set of filters that you need to pass your purpose statement through for it to be appropriate. There has been an awful lot of sustainability initiatives or purpose-driven enterprises which have really been marketing spin. I'd like to think we've gone beyond the greenwash of, you know, a decade ago in the sustainability space. But essentially, it needs to be something which correlates with the key objective of that organization. So, you know, you can't have an energy company and have its purpose to be, I don't know, making people feel better in local communities, for example. It has to relate to the core principles of the organization and its objective. And it's actually the purpose that I find challenges CEOs most, and I'm a bugger because I ask CEOs that question. So can you just tell me the purpose of your enterprise? And most of them start with this concept of, well, what we do is, as opposed to what we're seeking to achieve, which is really what the purpose is. What are you seeking to achieve? What's the outcome? As part of that, and it's no surprise that in our team we've invested heavily in impact and outcome measurement. You actually need to know how you measure success. We've challenged governments that they should be measuring success beyond GDP growth. We wrote a paper for the Institute of Chartered Accountants of Australia and New Zealand through their Future Inc. series, which I'd encourage you to read, which basically says GDP is a strange thing to chase after because it's driven not just by economic growth, but also by things like the earthquakes in Christchurch. Great example of huge GDP growth. We should all just have more earthquakes. So yes, the purpose piece versus mission is a subtle but important shift around the organizational aim and its wider context within society. So it's the broader stakeholder set, not just your shareholder. But I'll happily share. EY's got some publicly available information on purpose-led enterprises and how you create one.
Okay. Next question.
Yep. Thanks very much, Matt. I work for the Department of Conservation. I'm really interested in any commentary or reflections you've got on bringing back nature. So sustainability is great, and we're 100% behind that with businesses. What trends are you seeing around restoration and actually reversing the trend and bringing back nature?
I guess we feel. We don't have to worry here, do we? It's 100% pure, surely. So we are seeing a big trend in terms of the concept generally of natural capital. So for, you know, I mentioned the comment that Larry Fink had made. For too long, we've undervalued the environmental aspects of an organization and its impact. We're starting to see, for example, most standard setters moving towards the concepts of materiality that focus on the impact that those companies have on the environment, for example, as opposed to what's the importance of the environment and what impact does it have on your business. So a subtle shift, but actually a fundamental one. The Natural Capital Coalition out of Europe, which we've been assisting to try and come up with mechanisms of being able to quantify the impacts, deleterious or positive, to the natural environment. It's probably fair to say it's an area that New Zealand needs to focus on quite heavily, I would argue, particularly in relation to things like water quality, as we've started to see, here. It's not over yet, though, is my second comment. So a lot is going on in that space, but I think there's a lot more work to be done. We know, for example, measuring the value of natural capital is super tricky. And it's also reasonably subjective in some cases. So there is a lot of qualitative aspects. And that makes sense, right? I mean, if you're trying to value the biodiversity of a land bank in India and compare that with the value of a sea otter population in Canada, I mean, how do you kind of reconcile those two things? But we do in financial terms. So when there is an environmental disaster, we actually, you know, people like us come in and we quantify in dollar terms the financial impact on those natural environments. How do we know we're getting them right? I think there's still more work to be done.
Thank you.
I watched a documentary on water a little while back, actually on Netflix. What it was talking about was a large number of projects across the world, which is diverting rivers from one geographical area to another. Like, for example, the Nile, which goes through 10 different countries and starts off in Central Africa, and they're going to potentially divert it to their own country and aggregate their own land, which is like a desert. And then they also transfer to sort of China and what happens in Kathmandu, and the Indus River, which goes through China into India to Pakistan to Bangladesh, and that if the Chinese take that river away, basically almost half the world's population is affected.
Yeah.
I'm sort of interested in whether you had a comment on that. I noticed you had something about aquifers, but
Specifically in relation to rivers. Yeah. Look.
Well, as a trend of diverting water away from other people.
So the you know, but our litmus test, I guess, is you know, those savvy investors who saw the spark of the global financial crisis from investment in subprime mortgages all now have their money in water because of water risk. So they all see that as the major issue of the future. We know from research that's publicly available that demand for water already outstrips supply, but it's going to outstrip it significantly in the next 10 years in a manner of two to threefold, depending on who you believe. But we are starting, you know, the positive side of this is we are starting to see new and smart mechanisms of utilizing water appropriately. So I'll talk about a few things if you like. So the first thing is a greater move towards renewable energy is going to significantly help us with water demand, because I don't know if you guys know this, but thermal power requires an awful lot of water. And so the more we move towards renewables, the less water we'll need necessarily for those. But global consumption of food, the other major user of water is our agricultural systems, and our global consumption of food is predicted to go up quite significantly, so that's going to be an offsetting drain, I think, for that. But we are starting to see some interesting vehicles. So we are investing in this concept of impact, where you start to get flows of capital towards aspects like water, where you get a return on your money, but you also get an environmental benefit. So we've been working with the Nature Conservancy on their water fund. That's an interesting model in Australia. It's based on wetlands. I don't know if you guys know this, but wetlands need water when it's wet, and when it's dry, they don't need it. It goes into a sort of a hibernation stage, effectively, to dumb it down. But we've recognized that there's a great capital market play there, because if those wetlands buy a huge number of water extraction rights, which you have to have in Australia to extract from the river systems, then they can sell them to the agricultural systems when it's dry, because they don't need them, and it can buy them when it's cheap, when it's wet. And so they've been doing that to generate economic returns, and they siphon off an amount of that economic return for biodiversity improvements in those wetlands. So there's kind of been some great models that's been using classic financial systems to try and improve water management. But I completely agree. I think water's probably the bear on the horizon, I think, probably.
How are we going? Time for one more? Okay.
Thanks, Matt. I'm interested in what you were talking about in terms of smart cities, governments. I'm interested in your perspective on how business can actually help governments actually overcome some of the barriers they see to making the changes we need to make to get to the green line. Because it doesn't seem to me that governments are moving fast enough. and yet investors are saying this is what they want, so surely they are voters as well.
Yeah.
So why aren't governments making that connection in your mind, and what can we do as businesses to try and affect that a bit more for them?
Yeah, it's a really great question. I wish I had the answer. I don't think I do have the answer. In one respect, though, I would say the pace of change is outstripping the ability of governments to regulate quickly enough. And we also have this strange political environment right now, which is a move towards deregulation driven by a public sentiment that we have overly constrained and regulated marketplace around our freedoms. So there's, you know, I find myself arguing for one side and the other in the sustainability space because, you know, I want us to have our individual freedoms and I want us to make sure that we're upholding our UN Declaration on Human Rights, which many of these countries, including New Zealand and Australia, I believe don't do very well. But at the same time, you want governments to intervene because you see that there's a market barrier and a market failure that needs to be addressed. In truth, I think the trend that we're seeing is people are going around governments. I hate to say that, but Uber's business model is break the law until the law changes, pretty much. We're being recorded. I don't mean that. They're a great client. But they, you know, that's kind of proven itself out. They go into new jurisdictions. They allow their technology to be used. They don't push their technology. They allow it to be used. And the law ultimately changes because it sits on their side. And we're starting to see that from cities, where cities have the ability to intervene because they have their own planning. They have their own master planning processes. They just move ahead. And you're right. The companies and the customers are there to drive that change. Now, we've moved into a number of new buildings recently, and they are all 6-star, green star buildings because, you know, not only do we in the partnership want that, but our staff demand that. You know, we need to have a better, working environment that delivers a well-being outcome. We get a benefit from it, but our staff demand it. So I think it. I don't know. Sorry.
Time for one more, or do we need to wrap it up? Okay. Last question, and anything from Livestream?
Okay. First of all, thank you very much. As always, it's a really interesting presentation, and it kind of leaves us all feeling very inspired. But my question is, obviously, you know, even just one of these issues, climate change, is hugely complicated. And trying to understand how that interplays with all of the other megatrends and the influences that has in a, you know, social and political and organisational system. How can we as a group contribute towards meaningful change towards, you know, making progress in these areas? And as an organisation, what's Ernst & Young doing?
Really good question. I'd encourage you, well, I wouldn't encourage you to do what we're doing necessarily, other than to say we are thinking about how the SDGs relate to our business and what's most important. I actually think the Sustainable Development Goals are going to be a little bit of a coat hanger on which we can all kind of hang our coats and hats. These are complicated and the interrelationships between them are profound. However, your business or the area that you work in or the communities that you work with, however you engage in your day-to-day lives, will be more impacted by some aspects than others. And so we think fundamentally the most important thing this comes back to is materiality. Now, again, I sound like I'm critical of everything. I'm reasonably critical of materiality processes today, right? So I think the one thing that's missing from materiality processes is time. Many of you guys, I'm sure, in this audience would have carried out a stakeholder-based materiality assessment, and you'll all have done your graphs, right? You've got your impacts to the business on one axis, and on the other axis, you'll have the importance of that aspect to your stakeholders. Nodding heads, you've all done that. What's missing is time. Because most of those things, in the historic context of accounting, has always been, what does our business look like today and for the last 12 months? And that's how we reflect. And we've kind of just adopted that as sustainability professionals. And now we've got this quasi-state where we talk about things like climate change, but then we discount them so heavily back to today that they're meaningless. So we'll say, climate change is a very real and very important impact to our business. However, today we do not have the regulatory environment. It's not going to impact us for the next few years. So I think materiality needs to reflect time. Now, I think there's actually a very simple way of doing that. If you just score each of those against a short, medium, and long-term impact as a first initiative, if you start to look at the materiality of your business, then you aren't kind of taking in the universe. You're just looking at what's important today, but you're keeping your businesses mindful of what they have to be thinking about today for the future.